Hey, my name is David Khourshid, and I'm a web developer who is passionate about animations and front-end technologies. I created this course on CSS animations because animations bring user interfaces to life, and I want you to know how to add meaningful animation to your web projects. In this course, you will learn about CSS transitions, animations, custom properties, data attributes, choreography, animation states, layout animations, and reactive animations with a little bit of JavaScript. I hope you enjoy the course. So let's add some choreography to this animation over here, or lack of animation. Let's add some animation and some choreography to that. So what we're going to do is we're going to jump into style.scss, and we already have a few keyframes set up. Of course, we have the shake, but we also have slide up. So let's use that slide up and do a little bit of choreography. So first of all, we have the form sliding up, which is great, but now I want the input and the button to sort of appear after the form slides up. So we could add that same animation to the input and button, and let's see how that looks. So now you see they all slide up at the same time. We sort of wanted those to be a little bit separate from each other. So instead of this, I'm gonna separate this a little bit. We're gonna say animation name, slide up. We are going to give it the same duration. So animation duration, var animation duration. And we also want to give it the same easing. Since this easing is already on the parent, we could do this. We could say animation timing function inherit. And it's just going to grab that same easing. Now we want these to appear after this animation duration, which we've set in a CSS variable, so we could give this input a delay of that duration. So animation duration. And so let's see how that looks. Okay, remember, we need fill mode both. And I'd like to just use fill mode both as a default. At least when something like this happens, you know that we could adjust the fill mode. So now this is sliding up after the entire form slides up. Okay, so now we have to do a little bit of math here because the animation delay over here is going to be that same animation duration, but we also want it to happen a little bit after the input. So, instead of doing a lot of extra math here, again, you could hoist this up to the parent. So we could say that we have the animation duration over here. And so this is basically going to be the animation duration of both the input and the button. So for now, I'm going to set input duration. And this is just going to be the same as the animation duration. And so we could set that here, input duration. And so now instead of doing animation duration times two or animation duration plus animation duration, we could do a little bit of math here and just do calc the animation duration plus the input duration. So now this is going to appear right after the input appears. Now, of course, we could do a little bit of staggering here as well, or we could adjust like the durations. So let's say I want this input duration to actually be half the length of the total sliding up animation duration. So I could say calc animation duration divided by 2. And now this will happen a little bit faster, and the button will come in at the right time. So that's just one of the many examples that you could do with choreography. And hopefully you all had like a creative twist or, you know, just something custom that you wanted to do. But that's basically how you choreograph animations. So let's control this a little bit better with some JavaScript, just this same example over here. So we're going to be adding some, a script over here. And remember, we put the data state attribute on the app element. So what we could do is just have a way of like just toggling that from JavaScript itself. So first, like we showed before, I'm going to grab that app element, document.query selector, and we're going to grab the app. And then what I want to do is this button. So let's grab the button as well. Const button equals document.query selector. Well, it's just the same button. We're going to add an event listener so that when you click the button, we change the data states of the app. So button, call this button L. Dot add event listener, click. And we are going to say app L dot data set dot state equals loading. Okay, so now let's actually make this even more prominent. When this data state equals loading, let's just change the background to orange. So I'm just going to say BG. Let's call this, first it'll be white. And then we want it to be orange. So now for the entire app, let's just say background BG. OK. So now, right now it's loading just because the data state is already loading. So if we remove that, then we have a plain app. And when we click the button, now it changes to loading. So we could, toggle between these. And so we could read that data set state and say, if the data set dot state is already loading, then make it success. Otherwise, keep it as loading. So now it's going to basically toggle back and forth between loading, success, etc. Now, there's other techniques for how you could transition between states. One of my favorite techniques is by using an object. So I could just say const machine. And this is related to my other workshops on state machines. But you could do this like without using any libraries. So we could say machine, we have states, loading, success, and initial. This is just a plain object. And so we could say that we're starting in the loading state. And so on click, success. And in the success state on click, we go to loading. And so now instead of doing this, especially when your logic gets a lot more complex, we could just say read whatever the current state is and figure out using this object what the next state should be. So we could say const current state equals app L dot data set dot state. And so the next state should be the machine dot states. And so we're going to look for what the current state is. So we'll just do current state. And then dot on. And then we're just going to say this is a click. And if that doesn't exist, then just stay with the current state. And so now that is going to allow us to just use that logic and set the state from there. Now, you don't have to do all this, but it does make it a lot easier to visualize exactly how states can change in your app. So let's see, we have a little error. Cannot read on. Okay, so we want to get the current state. So that's going to be that or the initial state. OK, so yeah. Now we're going back and forth between the three. And so we could even, let's just have a start state. And then on click, we're going to go to loading. So it's going to start in the start state. And when you click, it goes to loading. And then when you click again, it's going to go to success. And then back and forth between loading and success. And to, again, going back to data state attributes, we could change the background to, let's say, green. make it a nicer green. So one of these greens. On the success state. So now, when we reload, we're toggling back and forth between each of those states. We just have to set the initial state to start. And there we go. Instead of it moving directly with your mouse, a lot of websites do this where it's actually doing a very smooth transition from where it was to your mouse. And so because the distance isn't known ahead of time, you can't just calculate keyframes or animation duration or anything like that on the fly. Instead, it's using a different technique in which there is no defined animation. So here's the technique. Let's say that instead of doing this, like going from this frame to this frame, like basically going from here to there, like the blue to the red in two frames, we want to do that over a series of frames, but we want to do it in a smooth way. Well, here's what we could do. Let's pick a fraction like 0.5. So with 0.5, we could say, hey, on the next frame, go halfway there. And then repeat. So on the next frame, go halfway there. In fact, that should be there, and there. And then repeat again on the next frame, halfway there. On the next frame, halfway there. On the next frame, halfway there. You get the idea. So if you look at this as sort of like positions over time, you could see that it's going really fast and then slowing down as it reaches its position. And by following the same formula, you could call it, by going only halfway every time, it doesn't matter where this is. So let's say that this is here. We're going to apply the same thing. So we're going to go halfway and halfway and halfway. And so you could see that, you know, over time, we're going from here to here, and it's smoothly animating to wherever your cursor is. All right, so how could we do that? Well, we could use both a combination of CSS variables and Lerp, which again stands for linear interpolation, I believe. Don't quote me on that. Okay, so how does Lerp work? So for Lerp to work, I'm just going to take these two over here. Let's keep track of our current points, which we're just going to say is x at 0 and y at 0, and our target points, which is wherever the mouse cursor currently is. So instead of setting the x and y from the event, we are going to set the target points to whatever that x and y is. So we're going to say targetPoints.x is client x, and targetPoints.y is client y. Now remember, over here, every animation frame, we want to move a portion of the way towards the target point. And so that's what's going to get us our smooth animation. All right, so that's something that we're going to do in the Lerp function. OK. So to do this, we have to calculate a couple of things. First of all, the delta between the x. I know this is sort of a flashback to our previous exercise on layout animations. But we're calculating the delta for the x value and the delta for the y value just to see how do we get to the middle of that of those two points. So const dx equals targetPoint.x minus the currentPoint.x. dy is the targetPoint.y minus the currentPoint.y. And then we are going to make the current point such that it's moving closer to the target point by some percentage. So to do that, we're going to say currentPoint.x is equal to the currentPoint.x plus a fraction of this. So let's just say 0.5, dx times 0.5. And then we're going to do the same here, dy times 0.5. And then we are going to set those styles inside of that Lerp function. So we're going to do it over here. OK. So This is going to run continuously, and I'll show you what I mean in a minute. So this is going to be currentPoint.x and currentPoint.y. Okay, so right now this isn't going to do much of anything, but you know, let's just take a look. So removing this, let me make sure that we have the right file. Let me just close this out. Oh, okay, so we actually need to call Lerp. Sorry about that. So whenever this happens, I'm going to call Lerp. Not Lert, but Lerp. Okay. So now it's moving. It's not moving halfway yet. You know, we still have to do that. And so that's something that we could do in an animation frame. So this is going to recursively call itself because, again, when we're moving somewhere, we want it to move halfway, and then we want it to do the same thing again. So move halfway, then halfway, then halfway, and so on until it reaches that point. So we're going to request animation frame, and we're going to Lerp again. And so let's kick it off by actually Lerping, and then that's going to recursively call Lerp every single animation frame. Okay, so by doing that, hopefully this works. All right, you could see that now it is smoothly animating to my mouse. And we did pick 0.5, and so that's going to make it go really quickly to our mouse. So it doesn't really look like it's being super smooth because it looks like it's just almost attached to our mouse. So to make this more apparent, I'm going to change this to 0.1. And so now, you see it's taking its sweet time getting to the mouse.